It's time now to get your game on with EA and Strike Fortress, a game designed to be used in the Chrome browser. We're joined by Daniel from EA to talk us through this. Red versus blue, we're in the middle of a game here. Walk us through the action.
That's right, we got two guys here who are playing. This is a blue team, and it's totally in the Chrome browser. We're using a JavaScript and WebGL based engine written from scratch, and they're communicating over web sockets to a client server architecture, just like you might play in any other multiplayer game. So just using all HTML5 technologies in Chrome.
So that is cool in and of itself, but you've got a tablet in your hand.
That's right.
To show us how you can actually sort of play God in this game. And let's shift over to the third screen here to talk about it.
So one of the dreams of this kind of experience is building a technology that can be experienced wherever you are. So when these guys are playing on their desktops, playing at home, or playing on their TVs in kind of a console setting, but I'm not there. I'm actually on my tablet, so
to mess around with the game.
That's right. Well, because I'm good friends with these guys, you know. And
not for long.
I have angst with this guy over here.
Yeah.
So I'm actually going to mess with their game by interacting with their game world and putting a mine right there where that guy can. Look, he hit in my mine. Oh, look at that. Sorry, guy. He didn't die quite though yet. So maybe I'll throw a missile on him.
So you could choose to mess around with red or blue team. I mean, you're in
control here.
Totally
benevolent or benevolent spirit, depending on how you feel in this particular game. And this is kind of a social game experiment, really, since we're doing a prototype build just purely for kind of research and design and building new technology. We experimented with the idea of a second screen smart glass controller to basically jump in the game wherever you are.
And you could also use your mobile device, your Android device as
yes,
well.
Yes, you certainly can. You can use, we have the new Nexus 7 they came out with today, totally. You can come up here and scan these QR codes we have on the wall and jump right into this game that's playing.
Now, what's the future of this technology? I mean, have you already thought about some sort of other iterations of this kind of sort of, you know, third-party interaction with a game like this?
No, for sure. Well, a technology like this, fully built out and then realized by a full game team with a vision, could produce a design that hits you perfectly wherever you are. So you can be on your phone with your couple second, you know, Facebook checking type experience that's super fast. You could be on the 2-hour console experience. You could be on the 10-minute more tablet experience. And each one of those would be fed to you differently to the same technology, but in a different stream, different data that you need based on where you are. And you as the user don't care. You just want to play your game in different ways wherever you have the time and can do that. So
now, without giving away the keys to the kingdom, any sort of tips or learnings from this for other developers curious on doing a similar thing?
Well, one of the most interesting things is that your JavaScript web programmers and your C++ and C game engine programmers tend to be different breed of people, and they don't live in the same world. And I guess we need to grow a new world of a community where they like to play in the same place with the same tools and the same
We've got some serious action going on here.
Yeah.
All right, well, we're going to finish up if you can maybe show us a quick demo again of what's going on here.
Sure. One last thing. I've been so mean, I'm actually going to help heal one of these guys by dropping him a crate. Get that crate. There you go. He's healed.
Aha.
So easy to just influence a game.
So you could be violent
or you could
provide some first aid. Or
One of the things we did with this game was that we made it super difficult to win unless you have people in the crowd that are on your side.
Uh-huh.
So it kind of is in their best interest too.
All right, so we'll encourage folks to drop by later.
Right, to come by and help out.
Daniel, thank you so much.
Thanks, Dan.
We appreciate your malevolence.
Appreciate it. thanks.
Okay, we're joined now by Jamie from the Chrome team to talk about a project that's redefining what it means to have a jam session. And I don't think I'm overstating that, because this is absolutely amazing. So walk me through what this is called and how people can interact with these instruments from anywhere in the world.
Sure. So at I.O. today, we're giving a demonstration of WebLab, which is a series of physical installations housed at the London Science Museum, and that can be controlled by anyone, anywhere in the world, through their browser in an immersive HTML5 experience. Now, one of those installations is what we're calling the orchestra, and it explores the theme of how the web has now enabled people from all over the world to come together and make things in ways that were never before possible.
And in this case, we're talking about making music.
So for music, what we've done is created 8 robotic mechanical musical instruments that are housed in the London Science Museum, and you can come to chromewebLab.com and take control of those instruments and make music with people from all over the world in a 3-minute jam session.
All right, this is a fascinating demo, and we should say this is absolutely live.
Yes.
In London right now, this is set up, this is no trickery, no pre anything.
No, not at all. Right, so this, it's coming up to 5 o'clock in the London Science Museum now.
Yep.
And if we go into the experiment, we can get a live video and audio stream directly from there.
Okay.
So we'll just give it a sec to load.
And just so people can know more, where can they go to find out information on this?
Sure. So at the moment, this is just an exclusive developer preview at I.O.
Okay.
You can go to chromewebLab.com to watch the teaser trailer. We're going to be launching in beta later in the summer, and then coming out of beta once we've got feedback, both online and in the museum, later in the year.
Okay. Or beta for those of us on this side.
Yeah, that's
all right.
Right.
So walk us through this. It's really
sure.
Cool.
So, once you've chosen to play the museum instruments, you have a choice of different instruments to play from. You can already hear that there are a couple of instruments being played by people. Let's say the vibraphone. That's my favorite instrument.
The vibraphone. Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
So it's just loading up the video and audio here, and we'll join the queue.
So if you want to be a participant in this, there's a queue for each instrument. You get a set amount of time to participate.
That's right. There's a queue, and each person has a 3-minute jam session, so there aren't huge backlogs that happen. While you wait, you can still go and play with any of the other experiments within WebLab. But we're already straight in.
Okay.
So let's go for it.
So folks who are at the museum are seeing this happen. Can they control some of these instruments as well?
That's right. So there's 8 instruments in total. During museum opening hours, 4 are controlled by people in the museum, and 4 are controlled by people online. The other cool thing about this project is that the Science Museum are letting it run for 24 hours a day, 7 days a year, for a whole year. And so at night time, all 8 instruments will be handed over to online users.
Which would be amazing to see
happening.
It's
a real kind
of
night at the museum type experience.
All right, so go ahead and play this vibraphone.
Yeah, so here we have a sequencer. You can see I'm the pink colors. The purple and blue dots are other instruments being played by people from around the world. So, you know, we're here in Moscone in San Francisco.
And there it is, it's playing.
It's this is the live video and audio coming through.
Yeah.
There's some clever stuff going on with WebSockets and Node.js to make sure that all the clients are synced and that the jam you're having with someone in Brazil or someone in New York is exactly the same as what you're hearing wherever you're playing from.
This is super cool. And just quickly, when is it available for everyone to try it out?
So from later in the summer, we're going to be going into beta and go to chromewebLab.com and follow Chrome's G Plus page to be the first to know when it all launches.
Cool. This is awesome stuff. Jamie, thank you so much for this tour. Appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you. Cheers.
Moving on to mobile now, and for fans of Chrome, you know that the Chrome Experiments for desktop has been around for a while, but the mobile experiments is very recent. We're joined by Boris, who's developer advocate at Google. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about mobile experiments, why it was created, and how people can use it.
Right. So we launched this project for the launch of Chrome for Android Stable, which happened just yesterday. And it's basically all the experiments are available on chromeexperiments.com. And if you're on a mobile device, you'll get redirected to the mobile version. So here I have the mobile version of the Chrome experiments on my phone.
Okay.
And the phone is being mirrored to this large display here so that you can all see what's happening on the screen.
Right. So we can. So anyone who wants to go and get some inspiration can go to the Chrome Experiments site.
Exactly.
Okay.
So Chrome Experiments initially launched as a community thing. So a lot of people just have been creating these great visualizations and other interactive animations and submitting them to Chrome Experiments for other people to get inspired and submit their own.
All right. So walk us through the first one you've got for mobile here.
Sure. So this is a multi-touch toy, and of course on mobile things are a little bit different. We have touch input, slightly slower CPUs, so a lot of these things need to be done on GPU.
Okay.
And a lot of the interestingness comes from multi-touch interaction.
Great.
So here you can see as I move my finger around on the screen.
Which that's really cool with just one finger.
Just one finger.
And can you pull it up just a little bit and we can see you've got more than one finger on
Let
there?
Let me switch modes as well.
Yeah.
Switch it to Galaxy.
Okay.
So here you can see, oh, sorry, that must have been bubbles. I'll switch it to Galaxy.
Yep.
And you can see the star moving around. Now, if I do multiple fingers,
uh-huh.
3 fingers, even 4 fingers, And this can track up to, I think, 10 or so touch points
at once. Can you talk to me about some of the technology involved with this?
Sure. So this is all being rendered on a large canvas element. Canvas is a standard HTML5 technology, and generally Chrome for Android supports many of the same HTML5 technologies that Chrome does. So here we have, you can see it's very smooth, very responsive. This is due to hardware acceleration. So pretty neat stuff.
Very cool. Now let's move on to the next one, which is sort of a way to spice up menu selections, which is part of so many different apps, but they can look sort of staid and not really that interesting. And
Absolutely. So
there's a new one here that they could provide some cool
ones. A totally new take on scrolling lists. So let me go back to the Chrome Experiments site.
Yep.
And here, you can visit this site as well on your mobile device.
Again, it's brand new, so there are just a handful of them there now, but more to come, obviously.
I think there's about 8, but we're going to open this up for external developers to submit.
Yep.
So this is the list experiment that we talked about, and you can see here what looks like a regular touch list comes to life when I start scrolling.
Oh, nice.
So these little arrows, or these things come slide into place.
Yeah.
And this is all done with CSS3 animations and transitions.
Nice. So we don't have much time left, so I'd love to get to the last example
if
we can, which is a game which is very, very popular for folks on mobile devices.
Right.
But in this case, it taps into what we were talking about earlier with that multi-touch ability.
Exactly. So the last one I'll show is called Finger Forest.
Okay.
And it is a side scroller.
Yep.
But again, it uses touch for input.
Okay. So they created a little game here to kind of illustrate it.
Yep. So basically, it's a forest, and the forest has acorns and squirrels in it.
Okay.
And you're the squirrel. And let me just show this on a different device.
Sure.
So you're the squirrel.
Yep.
And the idea is to bring the squirrel to the acorn and make it do a happy dance.
Okay.
So I'll just draw a line here.
All about the happy dance.
Definitely.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no, Horace.
So I seem to have failed that one.
Yep.
But if you succeed, eventually you get to levels where you have multiple squirrels and multiple acorns.
Okay.
And you have to solve the puzzle. And the trick is you need to keep your finger down on the screen for the whole time. Otherwise, it crashes. So it's a pretty simple little game. And what this uses, it actually technologically is quite interesting because it has multiple canvases layered on top of one another.
Okay, and here you could use the two fingers as well.
And here we're getting into two fingers.
All right, that's very cool. Boris, thank you so much for this demo. It's really, I think,
that's
the key. The point is inspiration for folks who are developing on the mobile platform, right?
My pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
And we finish up our visit to the Chrome area with Ido, who's going to do an unboxing of the Chrome Box, which has made a sort of a replacement for the desktop. And you're going to do it and get it all set up here in under 2 minutes. Is that right?
Exactly.
Okay. Ready?
You taking the time?
Go.
Okay.
Okay. So here's
the
box.
First, I just open it. It's packed real nice. Put it on side. First and foremost, just put the electric in.
Okay.
And then some, internet connection.
Still got the plastic wrap on it?
Too? Oh, yeah. That's fine. I'll just clear it if we want.
Okay. We've got all the connectors. Yep.
Yeah.
And tell me a little bit about the specs that's inside the Chrome Box.
So it's got a very nice CPU. It's run much faster than it used to be. And basically, this device is replacing a desktop. You're getting a very easy installation if I'm talking there.
And much smaller, obviously.
Much smaller. Desktops. The design is really sleek. And you'll see that now it's booting up.
Wow, that is under 30 seconds.
Yeah, and now actually we could set it. So it's really, really smooth and a nice experience. To set it up, and it's already checking the update. It will download now the latest software.
Okay.
And it's a very, very powerful device. I strongly recommend it to users.
Yeah. Now you're a developer advocate.
True.
At Google.
Yeah.
What's the response been on the Chrome Box, which has been out for a few months or so?
Oh, it was very, very great response. We got lots of great feedback that we are listening to, and then we're going to improve it over time. And just like in Chrome, every 6 weeks we're getting a new version in it, which is extremely important because then you have the speed, simplicity, and security all baked in and get improved over time. So unlike other systems, which over time you need to take care of them, this is actually getting better over time.
Okay, so the Chrome Box we have Of course, Chromebooks people know about already too.
Right.
What's the developer response been between the two of them in terms of?
Oh, amazingly, amazingly warm. And actually, on Chromebooks we have this huge battery life, so you could literally go and work with it for a full day. And the battery is very nice. The trackpad is amazingly good, and it's a very, very nice device. We mostly look at it as a producing content device. So the keyboard is very nice. If you need to write long essays, that's the device for you.
Okay, so are we almost, we're almost
Oh yeah,
set
I could
here,
just,
right?
Just log in to my
So very similar to a Chromebook experience.
Oh yeah.
You use your Google account.
And okay. Once I'm in, we have the sync. So everything that I worked and on other machines would be synced in automatically. So the exact point that I left my desktop, it's right here. We could take a photo just for the first time. I could actually take my photo.
Uh-huh.
You just took it from my G+. And at the first, we have this initialized screen to show you where, what's going on. And it's updating
all. Rolling, bringing in all of your tabs.
Everything, and, all my extensions, everything okay. that make me more productive. And I good and up to run.
That's great. I mean, obviously, it took a very, very short amount of time.
Oh, yeah,
I mean, that's really
you saw. I mean,
the purpose of this is to, of course, it's a great platform for developers, but it's such a seamless and easy experience to just boot up and
absolutely,
be able to be online.
Absolutely. And actually, in Chromebook, it will boot up less than 6 seconds, actually much faster than most of the time.
Seconds?
6 seconds from offline. So if you are just in sleeping mode, it's immediate. And if you are offline, it's probably six, maybe less.
Wow,
yeah,
that's
very impressive.
Fantastic.
Yeah,
you can't
yeah.
get much faster than that. Well, I suppose you can get faster than that.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's extremely fast.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
we did that because in that case, less is more. So you're getting less headache, less things that you don't really need and use day in, day out. And this actually great OS is built for people that spending the vast majority of their time on the web, which is
which
lots
is pretty
of
much
us.
All of us these
exactly.
days, right?
Exactly. So that's in that mind, this was the main goal to achieve, and I think it's working very, very nicely.
All right, Ido, thank you so much for that
thank
demonstration.
You.
That was
Definitely.
Fantastic.
Definitely.
And stay tuned for lots more here at IO Live.